Kaysing, who never made any secret of his inside knowledge, explained that the astronauts were never aboard the capsule when it launched. Instead, they came back down the gantry elevator and remained on Earth in secrecy for the duration of their mission. During that time, all the communications, videos, and flight data came from prearranged tapes that were transmitted via telephone wires.
I've always wondered, if Kaysing had so much inside knowledge, why didn't NASA threaten to kill him if he didn't keep his mouth shut? Wasn't that the standard contract when you went to work on the Apollo program? Didn't he have to sign such a non-disclosure agreement when he went to work at Rocketdyne? Welcome to Rocketdyne. You're now part of the extended NASA family. Don't say anything about the fake moon landings or we'll kill you. None of his sources wanted to be identified for fear of being killed by NASA's cunning assassins. So why wasn't Kaysing worried? And after Kaysing's tell-all book was published and nothing happened to him, why didn't other people come forward who were kept silent by NASA's apparent empty threats? Why did they all remain silent? Why haven't there been any deathbed confessions or open upon my death letters? And whatever happened to Randy Reed, who was listed as co-author when Kaysing self-published his conspiracist Bible in 1974, but disappeared without a trace when Health Research Books picked up his title in 2002. Perhaps his new publisher had some policy about putting a gag name with obvious sexual innuendo on one of their covers.
Let me ask you a question, and be honest. Do I make you horny, baby? Do I? Do I make you Randy? Yeah.
Curious. Most curious indeed. We will look into the claim about the astronauts not being on board later. For now, we will only examine the possibility of using Ma Bell to fake out the misfit operators. So let's continue with Jarrah's thrilling recitation.
In both editions of Kaysing's book, one comes across the following statement. Of utmost simplicity, once installed and checked out, was the radio data transmitted from the moon vehicle. Secret, leased, and well-secured telephone lines were connected to the antenna inputs of all space communication centers. These included the major tracking stations in Australia, Africa, and the west coast of the United States.
Africa. The third major tracking station was in Madrid, which is near Africa, I guess. There was a radio antenna at Johannesburg, but it played only a minor role during Apollo. Anyway, that's the least of the mistakes that Kaysing makes here. First off, Kaysing must have thought they somehow ran a wire from the dish antennae that simply plugged into a jack on the back of a receiver somewhere, like a home stereo system. He didn't realize that the dish antennae, used to receive microwave frequencies, are actually waveguide antennae that are completely different than what you would use for a standard radio. There are two major configurations of these antennae. In the arrangement used at parks, the feed horn, used for impedance matching to free space, and the receiver were actually built into the nose of the antenna. NASA's 30-foot and 85-foot deep space network antennae used a Cosgrain reflector-type design, which at microwave frequencies operates much like an optical reflector telescope. A secondary mirror is placed at the prime focus spot, which concentrates the radio signal into a feed horn in the center of the main reflector. This signal then travels down the waveguide to the receiver. In either case, the waveguide is coupled to the receiver through a hard line, a special pressurized cable. Impedance matching is important at the receiver end to maximize the signal-to-noise ratio and to avoid energy-sucking standing waves. Basically, there are no antenna inputs on the receiver to plug your telephone wires into. That makes Kaysing's claim mechanically impossible. Secondly, telephone lines in the 60s could not operate at the high frequencies used by the S-band receivers. Let's assume the Bell wire they used in the 60s was as good as what we use today for networking. Modern-day Cat5e with four unshielded twisted pairs is usually rated at 350 megabits per second, 350 megabaud, at a maximum length of 100 meters. But let's assume it will work at a higher advertised rate of 500 megabaud. Packets of digital data are multiplexed and shoved down each twisted pair in parallel, so each twisted pair has a maximum usable digital rate of about 125 megabaud. Digital rates are much faster than the maximum analog frequency of the wire due to error detection and correction techniques, but to forego having to argue the case, let's assume a twisted pair will operate in analog mode reliably at the Nyquist frequency, or half the digital sampling frequency, which in this case is 62.5 MHz over short distances. So the conspirators would have to transmit their bogus signal at or below 62.5 MHz. But the S-band receivers used at the tracking stations all expected to see a frequency-modulated or pulse-width-modulated signal riding on a carrier frequency in the gigahertz range. The frequency ranges are not compatible. It would be like trying to pick up an AM station on an FM radio. The 62.5 MHz signal would be totally ignored by a microwave receiver. So Kaysing's claim is technically impossible. Also, the maximum usable length for Cat5e cable is 100 meters, 328 feet, because the signal attenuates rapidly while traveling down the wires. So, the transmission source would also need to be in a relatively close proximity to the antenna. Basically, the signal would have to come from a van parked near each of the three major tracking stations at Canberra, Goldstone, and Madrid, as well as their wing stations and auxiliary sites. And they'd have to synchronize their transmissions so that they didn't skip a beat while switching from one station to another. So Kaysing's claim is logistically impossible. So where did the signals come from that the supposed conspirators sent down the telephone wires? Well, I wasn't able to squeeze everything into one 10-minute video, so we'll get to that in Part B. Ciao, Moon Hoax Conspirators, wherever you are.